Thank you. So before really beginning my talk, I want to say this is for me a real pleasure and honor to be here in this conference for Sergiu. So I want to say that, as shown by the beautiful talk by Igor, the works of Sergiu are not only sometimes very, very difficult, but and also very deep, but also really for Sergiu, mathematics are really a conceptual activity, that the concept plays really a role in his work, and I think that's for this reason he's a model for a generation of PDE people and analyst people. And to be a little bit more personal, that Igor mentioned a work I did some time ago with Heisenberg, and this is not random if this work has been done during Sergiu's stay in Paris at that time. He stayed in Paris in 1999, and this is during his stay that we proved the theorem, and his influence on this result is, as you can imagine, very, very important. And in particular for this, I want to thank him for this. So now I'm going to begin my talk. And so my talk is about, it's a little bit, it's so the analysis is officially a subject of this meeting. So this is has nothing to do really with PDE, but more than analysis. So the idea is to look at the Fourier transform for the Heisenberg group. So I apologize for experts of Heisenberg group, because I'm going to recall some very well-known facts about this Heisenberg group. So, and the motivation, maybe one word about the motivation, that we, after our book with Heger and Raphael about Fourier analysis and RD, we had the idea to study the Fourier analysis on Heisenberg group, because Heger works with Patrick Gérard and Chao Zhongxu about Littlewood-Pelle theory in Heisenberg group. And I work with Heger and Chao Zhongxu on some restriction of H1 space rate in on hypersurface for the Heisenberg group. And we have the idea to write something about analysis in Heisenberg group. And we were very surprised to discuss some very simple questions. That what's the Fourier transform in the Heisenberg sense of a tempered distribution? And we were very surprised not to see a clear answer to this question in the literature. So that's the question I am going to address. So this is a very simple question, and at the end you will see very elementary result. And you will see the sentence sounds very familiar. So I'm going to first to recall what the Heisenberg group is. So this is R2D plus 1, but we see R2D plus 1 has the product of the contingent space of RD times R. So this fact is the variable that in R2D doesn't play the same role, that's Y and eta doesn't play the same role, and the same role, and you see that eta is some sense the cotangent variable of Y. So you have you see the law of product. So the law of product, this is, you see you have the sum for the R2D, and for R you have the sum but perturbed by the symplectic form on T star RD. So this is non-commutative, of course. And the inverse of a generic element of this is minus W, so this is the same inverse as for the usual operation. And so this group is probably the most commutative, or the most close to commutative groups to RD. People familiar with in group theory, they say, well, this is almost commutative. But in fact, it is not. And all the problem is here. So you have dilation. So you see that because of this, the dimension of the vertical variable, the S here, is double. Okay? And of course, as in all groups, you can define convolution, and the convolution is a non-commutative operator. So now, let me recall that, and I'm going to write them, that the left invariant vector fields, I'm going to write them in the blackboard just to you memorize this, because they will play a role, of course. We are going, that's four. You have this one, and you have psi j, this is d minus yj ds. Okay? So this play really, these are left invariant vector fields, so for if you prefer right invariants, you change plus and minus, you intertwine plus and minus. And of course, notice that they commute except the two different of the same index, which gives you the derivative with respect to S. This is a very classical sub-elliptic systems. So the vector field xj and psi j, they are of order 1 in the following sense. S is of order 2, because here for S you have a square. And you have the Laplacian. The Laplacian is classically the sum of the square of the basic vector fields. Okay. So just for, I'm not going to use it, but you have the distance according to, this is a distance with rho. This is sometimes, like you see, this is, if you forget S, this is exactly the modulus. But here you see that S doesn't play exactly the same role. Okay. So this is everything is very classical. So this is a self-adjoint operator with domain H2. And its spectrum, this is the non-negative real line. So this is very classical result. So you have you have classical inequality, like RD inequality. You have also Poincaré inequality. And you have the fundamental solution of the Laplacian. This is, you have the same formula, the very analogous formula than in the case of RD. Everything works in the same way. So I don't mention the fundamental solution of the heat flow. It's a little bit more complicated. But this is, you have an explicit expression established, as far as I know, by Gaveau in the 70s. Usually, and this is very elementary. You copy the classical proof in the case of RD. The fundamental solution of the heat flow, this is much more, there is a formula, but the proof uses Brownian motion. The original proof uses Brownian motion. It's much more delicate. Okay. So now, what's Fourier transform? So Fourier transform classically. So maybe I'm going to enter some suspense. So the Fourier transform classically, you lose in the commutative case, you lose the characters. On Heisenberg groups, the characters are the same as the characters of R2D, of R2D. So if you try to use a character, it will not depend on the mean value with respect to the vertical variables. So forget any inversion formula. Okay, so this is not the good way to do this. And people in group theory, they know, and this is known for a very long time, that you have to use representation theory. So here you have, for the Heisenberg group, you have a choice. You can use Bergman representation. I am not going to use this. And you can use Schrödinger representation. So what's Schrödinger's representation? For lambda different from zero, you can define a morphism between the group HD into the unitary group of L2 with the following formula. Okay? This is an irreductible representation of HD. And you have the definition of the Fourier transform. This is simply you take the integral over HD of f of w multiplied by this operator. And of course, it gives you a bounded operator on L2. So with such a definition, what's the Fourier transform of an L1 function on the Heisenberg group? This is a family of bounded operators in L2. Okay? And the family, the dependence of a real parameter lambda, which is not zero here, classically. So this is a classical definition. Okay. So you have some inequalities that are quite familiar. So you imagine that L infinity, this represents the equivalent of the L infinity bound in the classical case. So So this is, you take the L2 norm in lambda, it is F in L1, because this is, of as an operator, this is norm 1. And you have this, here, you have this inequality. So this inequality is a little bit more unusual. So this inequality, the proof, I'm not going to do the proof, but the proof is that it put in light some relation between risk representation and the vacantization. So take lambda equal to 1. Take lambda equal to 1. Up to this multiplication by this factor, the U lambda is exactly the phase symmetry applied to the symmetries, the symmetries of the function phi. So you can see this formula for lambda equal to 1 as a quantization formula applied to the very quantization formula applied to the symmetrized function of phi. Okay? So I'm not going to use this point of view, but it's just a remark that this Heisenberg group is also related with a lot of things of geometry, mathematical physics, and so on. So, for instance, you can refer to the last two chapters of the books by Elias Stein on harmonic analysis. Okay. So now, the question there is, of course, a fundamental relation that has expected the Fourier transform, that it transforms the convolution into products. So there is no surprise in this formula. So this is very, this is actually algebraic. This is very simple to prove. This is, all of this is very classical. But you expect also something more about Fourier transform. You expect that Fourier transform provides a diagonalization of the Laplacian. Of course, this is the case in RD. In the case of RD, you have this formula. So you expect something like this in the case of Fourier transform, say, in Heisenberg group. So to do this, you compute what the Fourier transform of the Laplacian. And this is, oh, sorry, something missing here. So this is a very simple computation. You take here, you apply to some function phi, you make integration by part in the integral, and you find this. So you find that the action of the Laplacian translated in terms of Fourier transform, this is the action of the harmonic oscillatory with some dilation factor, lambda. So you see, of course, that lambda equal to zero is a singular point, and this will play an important role in this talk. Okay, so this is very easy computation. So if you want to make something diagonal with this, you will see immediately that appear Hermite function. Okay? So let me denote by Hn the collection of Hermite functions on Rd, and you make some dilation of this Hermite function, so this notation, just to ensure that there are eigenvalues of this operator with the factor lambda here, okay? Oh, sorry, there is a minus sign here, which is missing, sorry. And you have this. And there is some important relations that they play a role in the proof that when you multiplied an Hermite function, you have this formula here. You can, you have explicit formula when you multiply the Hermite function, and when you differentiate the Hermite function between Hermite function, basically you have some shifting of the index. So this is because you compute by iteration the Hermite function with the creation operator, and you have the which is minus dj plus mj, and you go up with this operator, and you go down with the annihilating operator, which is the differentiate dj plus mj, which is a multiplication by the factor xj. Okay? This is very easy to prove. This is very simple computation, but I think it's important to have them in mind. So you have, when you have multiplication and differentiation, you make some shifting in the scale of the Hermite function with this factor here. We see here, of course, n plus delta j. This is you add 1 in the index of in the integer of length of index j. Okay. So now, we want to see the Fourier transform as a function. This is really because people are, a lot of, mentioned people that work and have made a lot of work on this, that you have Geller, Ulaniki, Tangavelu, Faro, and so on. So many, many people work on this, so I cannot mention all of them, but I mentioned a part of them, so sorry for the others, but they are in idea that the Fourier transform of Heisenberg group, this is operator. What we want to say is that if you want to go to distribution, I want that the Fourier transform is a function. I want to say it's a function of something. And in fact, when I am doing something which is very simple, that I have an operator, I take, this is simply the matrix. But here what we consider, the value, we consider the set here, which is the, H hat D, which is N to D times R. So we see the index of line and the index of column as a variable, okay? And we consider this is simply the matrix of this operator, taken in the base of the Hermite function with dilation. And for lambda equal to zero, we want to go to lambda equal to zero. For lambda equal to zero, this is simply the integral of f when n equals to m, and this is zero if n is not equal to m. So this is not very surprising that the value of the Fourier transform in zero, this is the integral. So there is nothing very new in this, but really, this is the point, all the point of this talk is really to understand how the Fourier transform behaves when lambda tends to zero. So if you, I make the analogy with Veyler-Mander calculus. If you take it of Veyler-Mander calculus, I'd say for lambda equal to one, this is a quantization, related to Weyl quantization. If lambda is large, this is exactly the semi-classical pseudo-differential quantization. This is a semi-classical quantization where lambda is large. But with lambda is small, this analogy is singular because you violate the incertitude principle. So this is delicate and you have to investigate what's going on when lambda equal to zero. So as I mentioned at the beginning, we want to extend the Fourier transform on S prime. So what do you need to extend the Fourier transform on S prime? Of course, you need something that you know to what's the range of S. What is the range of S with it? What is this function? And you have to understand what is this. So we have to understand this. Okay, so I am going to start with some very elementary result. So this Bessie's lemma. So you see this lemma, this is just the translation of the lemma when I observed that it was the Laplacian, it was the harmonic oscillator acting on the function. So when you take the matrix, this is really, this is a diagonal form of the Laplacian. You see here, you multiply the Fourier transform by this, okay? So this is, and this is index n, of course, because you multiply to the right, okay? So it corresponds to, in terms of matrices, it corresponds to the product with the diagonal matrix with this element composed on the right with this matrix, okay? And so you have a diagonal structure for the Laplacian. And you have also another identity, which is this one. So this lemma, this is simply, you have computation, this is integrated by parts in the definition, so there is nothing in this. Notice that for radial function, this is zero, okay? And it gives you some decay. So this here, you see on F, these derivatives, you can compute this operator in terms of this one. So this is, this inequality, this is really the classical fact that regularity gives you decay. And the decay, this is this one. You see, in lambda equal to zero, you have no decay with respect to m or n, but you have decay in n minus m. So away from the diagonal, it decays very fast, far away from the diagonal. Far away from the diagonal, it doesn't count really. What happens doesn't count really, okay? So this decay, this is the base. And as we want to put some structure on the space, the set HD hat, that is something which is the equivalent of the dual of a group, that's a set of characters, but this is not. We have no equivalent. We know this gives you the measure. So the measure, you want this function are integrable, of course. So you take this measure. So now what I take this, I define the measure like this. I take the sum over n and n and the integral with respect to lambda to the power d lambda. Just because I want that this function, this weight with negative power is integrable. Okay? So this is a very natural choice. Well, now we are going to look at the regularity outside of at zero, because outside zero, this is very easy to realize that the map that associates to lambda associates the Fourier transform in n and at point lambda is smooth outside, sorry, this is outside lambda equal to zero, and it's continuous at lambda equal to zero. So this is a singularity, but not that much. So, first of all, so I'm going to write down this formula, because this formula will be, it turns out to be important. You see the Fourier transform, you put some, you make some change of variable in the definition, and you find, I'm going to write this formula, okay, because it's important to have it in mind. So, there is nm and lambda, this is this. This is the Fourier transform of f with respect to variable eta and s, and at point, this. And multiplied by hmn lambda x, hm lambda x prime, dx dx prime. This is, this formula is important. Okay? So, by Taylor formula at order 1, you can see that easily that for fixed n and m, you can substitute by 0, 0 here. So here, of course, you have a power of lambda. And here, of course, you have a factor lambda, a sum of factors of type lambda xj plus x prime j. But here, you multiply here, you lose lambda 1 half to have some multiplication because of the dilation here. And you still have lambda 1 half. And then it's very easy, because simply you see that this, by change of variables, this is simply the convolution of this function by hn, scalar hn, after a change of variable. But this tends in L1 to the integral times the direct mass. Okay, so this tends to hm in L2, and as they are orthogonal, it's exactly delta nn, okay? And this is the integral of f, because the value, this is the integral with respect to this variable, and the Fourier transform in eta s at 0, 0, it gives you exactly the integral, okay? So, the singularity is not too bad. So now, if you go back to our program, you have to remember. Sorry, I'm going south for almost undergraduate course, so I apologize. So in the classical case, you have a bilinear form. You can see the Fourier transform as this bilinear form, and with Fubini's theorem, and you see this is this. Okay, this is this f, and here I put the, I distinguish. Usually, we see RD in RD star, this is the same set. But here I don't want to see R and RD star as the same set. Okay, and this, for instance, you see that if F and theta are in L1, so this binary form is well defined, which is not a surprise. But when F is in L2 and theta is in L2, it's also well defined. This is Fourier-Plancherel. And if F is in S prime and theta in S, this is well defined. This is formula and this is the definition. But you see here, you have you transpose two times, in fact. Because you first, you transpose saying by this, and then you transpose with distribution, okay? So what, in fact, we have to study is the transpose of the Fourier transform. But to make this, so what we want to do in our case, we simply want to see you have, by definition of the Fourier transform in the ideal group, we have this, the bilinear form is given by this. Okay? And with Fubini's theorem, you can write it like this. F. And then, if you know that this is a function of F, you can define this as for F in S prime. Okay? So what you have to do, you have to understand the range of S. You have to understand what's the range of S by the Fourier transform and to understand the action of the transpose application and so on. So the answer is very simple. The range of S, this is S of H hat. So the question is, what S of H hat? Okay. What is this? Of course. And what will be the Fourier transform of the tempered distribution? It will be a linear form on this space. So I have to just to understand what is this space. Okay. So you see, this space, you decompose the Fourier transform into two. There is a part which is not very difficult and even not very relevant. This is this part. Okay? And you see the formula here. Simply I substitute this by this. And everything, this is this operation. And what's this operation? You see, you take a function S of R 2D plus 1, and you take this variable here, and then what is this? This is a function of E con X prime, and you take the projection on the orthonormal basis of L2 of R2D. This is an orthonormal basis of L2 of R2D, and this is simply the projection on this. You take the projection, you project on each vector here. Okay? So this is an L2 orthogonal projection. Okay. And what word you see here simply, I substitute it by phi, and this is the definition of P. So for P here, for PH of phi, simply, this is the same here, and just you put phi, okay? And of course, this doesn't change the range of S, of course. So the real problem, this is this. And you see here, there is a real problem, because you introduce, even here you have no singularity in lambda. When you take the projection here, it doesn't have any meaning for lambda equal to zero. So all the difficulty is to understand what's going on with lambda equal to zero. Okay. So really the point is the understanding of this, and as I came, and I insist on this, I introduce a singularity at point lambda equal to zero, which is not present at the beginning. And all the problem is to understand what becomes for this point, in fact. Okay. So there is a dictionary. I'm going to write it because it's important to have it in mind for that follow. So when you take the Fourier transform with respect to eta and s, of course, you change the operator here. And here, you have a new operator, which doesn't change the derivative with respect to y, but here this is in the new variable. So the new variable is z. Okay, this is variable z, okay? And here, you have this operator, right, which is minus 2 lambda. And you can, the multiplication, you have another dictionary, this is a multiplication by xj plus or minus eta j, and so this is a multiplication by this, and it becomes, here, it becomes the multiplication by yj minus plus the derivation of this. Okay. And of course, I think you can remember this. I'm not writing it. Okay. So of course the multiplication by S I take the Fourier transform with respect to S, so this is the derivation with respect to lambda. So, first proposition. What? Now, I want that decay, the idea, I use probably regularity gives decay. I previously did it. But now what I want to understand is that decay gives regularity. So decay, this is this operator. I have to understand the action of this operator with this. And this is written here. So just a word about, and of course this is valid for lambda different to zero. Just some comments on this. The proof of this, this is not very funny. So you put nj in the definition here. You make multiplication, integration by part. You lose the formula of products of by xj and derivatives of the Hermite function, and you find the result. Okay, this is purely tedious computation without any thinking. So now, have a look at this operator. Why this is a regularity? This is regularity. The reason why, take for instance, the result of this for n equal, take the value of this operator at point n plus delta j and n plus delta j. So take here, n. Take the value of this. You see here you have nn and you have n. You have n plus 1, n plus 1. And here you have the same, you have ng plus 1, ng plus 1. So it gives you that when lambda tends to 0, the limit that we know, but it gives you that the limit, it gives you that this difference. Tends to 0 when lambda tends to 0. It gives you regularity. Okay? This operator gives you regularity. It gives you exactly this. Okay? Because you apply this you, for w hat equals this quantity. You find exactly here n plus delta j, n plus delta j. And it gives you it tends to 0 when lambda tends to 0 because you divide by lambda 1/2. It gives you the regularity lambda 1/2. It gives you Eulerian regularity 1/2. Okay? So it gives you that all the value of this are the same. So it gives you regularity. This is regularity. Okay? So something worse, the derivative with respect to lambda. It gives you this operator. Okay. So I just explained the proof. The proof, this is this, so you can forget it. The proof is very, is all the proofs are not very complicated. You differentiate, you apply the differential until the integral, you apply the Leibniz formula and the chain rule to get this. And after, you have relation on harmonic. So here you apply also the chain rule, you have relation on a Hermite function and you use this operator, okay. So I'm going just to forget this this proof now to confirm what does it mean. In fact, using the operator L plus minus J before, you can prove that this is bounded by 1 over lambda 1/2. So it means that the derivative is bounded by lambda to the power minus 1/2. So it gives you that there is a limit on the left and on the right. So this is regularity with respect to lambda. Okay? So the translation of the regularity of lambda in the setting of the H hat D, this is this operator. Okay. This is an since this is an order 2 operator. Lambda is of order 2. Okay. So now what can we do with this? We will see that we can do regularity up to, this is piecewise smooth with respect to lambda. But we need to have the continuity, and the continuity is given by this. So take this operator here, and you define this operator. This operator is an exercise to see that D0 maps S R T 2D plus 1 to itself. This is an elementary exercise to see this. And this, you have this formula. So it tells you that this operator is good. And now, when n equals to n, this is 1. So of course, this is the same. And it gives you that if there is a limit for lambda positive and lambda negative, the limit is the same. And you have regularity. That's the way you get regularity. I'm going to explain this more in more details after. But you see, so how to prove this? So this is not very complicated to prove, that you have your definition and you introduce this function. Of course, you see this is this function. And now you make the following change of variables here, and you find exactly this one. But you see that the Hermite functions, they are odd or even, depending on the fact that n is odd or even, and it gives you exactly this result. And by definition, this is exactly this, with minus 1, and when you interchange m and n. So it gives you the formula. Okay? So this is nothing very difficult. Okay? So now, we can define the space S and prove that the Fourier transform is in S. What's the space S? So consider S0, the set of continuous bounded functions. So I say continuous for the topology induced by the usual topology. And this is probably something I'm going to explain at the end. This is probably wrong. This is not the right topology. I'm going to explain you why at the end. But that's for the time being. So I did at the beginning, this is a work in progress. So I'm convinced this is not the right topology. Of functions that are continuous and that decay with this decay. Okay? And I want that these functions, they are smooth functions, outside lambda equal to 0. And when I applied all the operator like this, I find I remained in S0. So the operator, I define this one. And this, the operator that associated to the derivations. So I didn't define them. So this is operator close to some multiplication that gives the decay here. Okay. So their own formula is not important. That operator that gives the decay here. Okay. So this is S. So here you see you have decay, and you have differentiation operator. Okay. So you have a space S. So this is a space S. And the computation I made that there is no choice. There is no choice because each operator corresponds to an operator on S. So this is the right space. Okay. So probably you can argue that all these operators are not enough. So probably there is very different ways of defining seminorms on the classical Schwarz space. For instance, you can have seminorms, take the Laplacian of Heisenberg group, and ask it decay fast. This seminorm, this family powers of Laplacian decay fast. This family of seminorms you can prove is equivalent to classical seminorms on S. So probably there is more accurate seminorm than all this. Probably you don't need all of this, but I take all of this. Like in the classical case, in S you have different families of seminorms that give the same space. Okay? So now, the inversion formula, version 1, that the theorem that this map PH, that I recall this written here, so instead of this here, this you substitute by phi, this is the same formula, you just substitute it by phi. And the inversion formula is given by this formula. And it maps continuously the space, and it's an isomorphism between this space and this one. So have a look on this formula. I claim that this is a smooth function with respect to lambda. Because I claim that this function is in S of R2D plus 1. And see here, you say there is this is crazy. There is singularity in lambda equal to 0, of course, because I divide by lambda equal to 0. Okay. So this seems crazy, but this is true. I'm going to explain you what this is true. The reason why is that, in fact, of course, you have a singularity at lambda equal to zero. But the way everything is encoded is what you want on this function. And this function, the operator I defined before, kills the singularity here and gives you a smooth function here. Okay. I'm going to explain. I'm not going to make the computation, because the problem is that you have to reverse all the computation I did before. So it's a little bit annoying, but simply the steps. And also, you have a Fourier Prandtl formula, which gives you this. And why this? This is very easy, because this is projection on an orthogonal basis. So this is trivial, in fact. So first, use lemma and proposition 1, 2 to prove decay and piecewise regularity outside lambda equal to 0. That's what I explained. The proposition, the way the translation of this operator, this multiplication operator, and the multiplication by the derivation by lambda gives you decay, and all this operator gives you decay and piecewise regularity outside lambda equal to 0. Okay. Because the derivative with lambda blows up as 1 over lambda, 1/2. So you have a Cauchy condition, you have a limit. So by continuity, you can propagate. You have this is okay by continuity. And then the question is, why this is smooth? Simply because proposition 3 says you that the difference between the lambda and minus lambda, this is less than the constant time lambda. So this is continuous. And you are done. Okay? So you have this inversion. And now you have and of course, use the fact that this is on orthogonal basis. You find this is trivial. Okay. So now you have a translation of this in terms of Heisenberg group. You have the fact that the Fourier transform on Heisenberg group is an isomorphism between S of I H D and S of H hat D, and you have the following formula. Okay, and you have this Fourier Prandtl formula. So here, there is something, I don't develop this, but you can, in the computation, you can write this in the language of, in fact here, if you change variables, this you call it z over lambda, you call it z prime, you find something related to the Wigner transform of the Hermite function. And you can write this in the language of Hermite function, but what happens if you do this change of variable? Here, of course, you get the regularity is given because you have oscillation here. But here, you have if you do this change of variable, you have here a positive power of lambda. When lambda tends to zero, you have no oscillation, so you have no regularity. Anyway, you have something to do. Okay. So you can argue what's the classical vision of in group theory. In the language of group theory, of the inverse Fourier transform. So we recover it, of course. Because if you apply this formula for W equal to zero, you find exactly this. So consider, here I substitute theta, I consider this is the Fourier transform of F. I can write it like this. But if S equal eta equal Y equal to zero, this is exactly this. So then when you change variable, you find exactly this, because this is an orthonormal basis of L2, so you find exactly this. And what is this? This is exactly the trace of the operator F. This is the trace of the Fourier transform of F at point lambda, but the Fourier transform seen as an operator, okay? And this is a classical, if you open any book about the Fourier transform of on Heisenberg group, you will see this formula. Okay. And people after, they make translation, and they put a translation here. What I think is that this formula is much more explicit. Okay. And it's much more explicit, and we can use it for duality. So now we are in position to define the Fourier transform on S prime. So what we define? We define a tempered distribution on H hat. This is simply the set of the continuous linear form on the set S of H hat. And for instance, for a bounded function or for a good function, you have the duality here. This is simply the integral with respect to this. This is as usual. Okay? You have a duality like between function and linear form on the space as usual. This corresponds to the L2, L2 identification. Except there is no bar here, there is no complex conjugate. This is exactly like the classical case. And then we can define, you see that the BF, the bilinear form I write before, the Fourier transform of F applied to a function theta in the duality between the space on H hat, this is exactly F applied to the transposition of the Fourier transform applied on theta with the following formula, with this. When you transpose, you have this formula. Okay. And you can notice that this, this is exactly related to the inverse. Of course, because you have an L2 relation in norms, so this is very natural that the transposed operator and the inverse are related. And you have this. Okay? So you know that the transport operator maps the set S of H hat into S of HD. And everything is very well defined. Okay. So now, to conclude the technical part of this course, just make classical exercise, as personally asked to students, what's the Fourier transform of the Dirac mass? Okay. And what's the Fourier transform of 1? And the Fourier transform of 1, it's more difficult. Fourier transform of delta, this is easy, because this delta is almost in L1, so this is easy to write. And you see the Fourier transform of delta, this is the function, the characteristic function of the diagonal. Okay. So this is a function, you can imagine this is 1, in some sense. This is 1. So what does it mean? This is exactly the identity, this is the matrix of the identity. It doesn't depend on lambda. And this is a matrix of identity. So in terms of the operator, the Fourier transform of the Dirac mass was identity. And so, and you see this in all the books, in the or all papers dealing with this, you see this formula. This is not. But for one, it's more tricky. Okay? It's more tricky because what's the transform of one? This is the Dirac mass on H hat of D. It means that, in fact, the Fourier transform of 1 applied to theta up to a factor, this is theta of 0. Okay. So we have the familiar fact that essentially, up to a constant, the Fourier transform of 1, this is the Dirac mass in 0. Okay. So the proof of this is trivial, you see. Just for fun, you see, you have the Dirac mass applied to this. This is simply this function, and it acts as the integral, so it represents the function 1. Okay. 1, and then, of course, you kill all the everything what's outside the diagonal is killed. For 1, well, okay, you see, you write the definition. You know this function is integrable, and you know this is, in fact, Fourier minus 1 up to some constant and some change of sign. But what's the integral? The integral, this is Fourier h at point 0, so this is theta of 0, and you are done, okay? So, now, I say the work in progress was the perspective. But the perspective is really to understand the structure of a h hat of d. When I say the topology is the wrong topology, because you see all the functions I deal with on h hat d, they, in lambda equal to 0, they have the same value with n equals m. So I can consider all these points are equal, are the same point. There is only one point. And in another way, when n is different to m in lambda equal to 0, all the function vanishes. So as a set, in lambda equal to 0, there is only two points. So if you identify it, you see the picture of the this set. You say this is a countable. This is a countable line, number of lines. In each point of n 2d, you have a real line, lambda. It's r times this space. But in fact, you identified all the points in zero. You identified all the points. That all the points is zero and n, it's only one point. Because all the functions have the same value. So topologically, this is the same point. Okay? And you see this, in fact, if you put a topology like this, this set has only two connected components. Because you have, this is like two cones with a countable direction. So I think this is interesting to, so maybe some perspectives at the understanding of the structure of this space, H hat D. Just this remark, you see, topologically, it's not N to D times R, because you identify, there is some identification at lambda equal to zero. So this is a singular set at lambda equal to zero. Okay? So that's the first point. So this is not easy to, I define the set of distribution, but you can ask me what looks like a distribution on such a set. Well, I give you trivial examples. But for non-trivial example, I think there is some study to do. And even if you give me a function of lambda n and m, and you, even if it looks good, if you ask to me, is it in S, the answer is not totally trivial. For instance, if you take the heat flow, you know what the heat flow is, because I say the Laplacian, this is a multiplication by modulus of lambda m. So you know what the heat flow is in Fourier space, this is e to the power t modulus of lambda length of m plus d. And you have to be careful if you want to check that this is in S. It's true, we checked, but you have to make the computation carefully. So this, I think this space S of HD has some there is something not totally clear in this space, and I think there is some study to do just to understand the structure of this this space. So another direction, which is probably more prospective, but that's to some pseudo-differential calculus. Once you know what a smooth function of W and W hat, which is in some sense the dual variable of this, you can have smooth function, you have symbol, what is a symbol like this. So there is a work of Bowry, Gallagher, and Fermanian about pseudo-differential calculus and the Heisenberg group, which is not exactly written in terms of this. So I think there is something to investigate. In some sense, this is a cotangent variable of W. So what an algebra of functions, like in pseudo-differential calculus, you have a very natural question, what function like this, which is by some the quantization you imagine will give a bounded operator in L2, for instance, which is question, I think, is not totally obvious. So, thank you for attention, and happy birthday, Sergiu. Yes, there is. So this is a work in, it said, originally done by Bowry, Gérard, and Chu in 2000. And so they make a very great job, but unfortunately they choose Bachmann representation. And Bachmann representation is used by people in complex analysis for reason, certainly very good reason. But you see here, you can imagine that the problem with Bachmann representation is that you have a family of operator bounded, but the space depends on lambda. And it degenerates in lambda equal to zero. So if you want to study the singularity lambda equal to zero, this is not exactly, this is much more complicated because here the space L2 is fixed. So you can go through in lambda equal to zero. But with Bachmann representation, it's much more difficult, and the formula are much more difficult to write than with the Schrödinger representation. Of course, they are equivalent. You have formula to translate, but the formula are complicated. And for instance, I think written this in the Bachmann setting, I think it's probably very much more complicated than the Schrödinger setting. So, but there is a theory, and for instance, you can also prove that study dispersion, for instance, and dispersion is a very, very different has in RD, for the reason that you see that in the spectrum, in the variable, the dual variable, you have discrete you have discrete value, and with discrete value, you have no dispersion. Okay. So you have contour examples. I think for wave equation, you have only dispersion 1/2, with power 1/2, the dispersive inequality. And for Schrödinger, I see there is no dispersion at all. There is explicit example. Okay. So this is very different. But the Littlewood theory is done. And one of the difficulty is that if you want to do some paradifferential calculus, you have the difficulty of the Littlewood theory is that to prove that if you have a function whose Fourier transform is supported in a ring, in the sense that here will be that you have lambda m plus n equivalent to some constant, okay? And if you have a function which is the Fourier transform of which is supported in a very small ball, when you make the product, you find a function the Fourier transform of which is supported in a ring. Because you know, in RD, this is very easy because the Fourier transform of a product, this is a convolution of the Fourier transform. But here, I don't speak about the problem, but the Fourier transform of the product of two functions, because I cannot write the formula, to tell you the truth. I cannot write a decent formula. Of course, I can, with inversion, I can write something, but I cannot write really, an efficient formula. Okay, that's the point in Littlewood pair theory, which is difficult. And as far as I know, it can be solved in a paper by Bauri and Gallagher.